some everyone of us who are online, who are listening to us, and I pray the grace of the Lord will not depart from your life in the mighty name of Jesus. It is a great privilege for us to come together like this and sit together to feed our spirit and soul. Because we know the protocol of the kingdom, that the journey ahead of us is still far. We know that the journey ahead of us is still far. And I said it earlier, that the first time Elijah has this privilege to sit under the conference room of immortality, the angel whispered to his soul, he said, sit and eat now, for the journey ahead of you is still far. So we know it's a call of God upon our life. It has become a burden in our spirit. It has become a hunger in our soul. It has become a reality in our body, in our existence, that the journey ahead of us is still far. So there is a call in the trumpet room of God that we need to gather to begin to eat. And that is why we gather here tonight, so that we can eat and continue the journey ahead of us. And I pray that God Almighty will give us the grace to swallow this food and eternity want to feed us with tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Now permit me to begin the message. And I title it, the war to call and a call for war. The war to call and a call for war. If you are with me, wherever you are, you can just turn your Bible to the book of Revelation chapter 5. I'm going to read verse 5. But permit me to summarize verses 1 to 4. It was a journey of an information that happened in the throne room of heaven, where John was privileged to come up either and begin to see the reality that was happening before and after the existence of man. It was privileged to enter into the corridor of eternity, where a decision was made about the reality of earth. And what he saw in John, in Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 to 4, was that a book was opened. A scroll was opened. And there is no man in heaven, there is no being, there is no immortality that has the capacity to open that book. And he become a body, and he become a cry in the heart of Apostle John. So the information, the good news we want to talk about, was what the heaven whispered into the soul of John about the reality of what's happened in heaven that we want to discuss tonight. So verse 2 and 3 make us to understand that opportunity was given to every being of immortality to open a book, to open a scroll. And the Bible said no man on earth, has no man in heaven, had the capacity to open. He said there was a silence in heaven. There was a silence in heaven. And the silence kept on persisting. Eternity began to watch. Who will have this capacity to come into the reality and cosmos of man and begin to solve the problem of man? The Bible said there was a silence in heaven. And the good news was whispered into the soul of John in verse 5. And that is where I want us to read now. Please just pay attention to that verse 5. You will see the reality of what the message we want to talk about tonight is talking about, which is a war to call and a call to war. Because the purpose of the message is what I want to open the eyes of understanding of people to see, is that before we are called, there was a war. And after we are called to war again. Let me repeat. Before we are privileged to be among the call, somebody fought it. And the moment you are called, you are not called for ordinary to be living a natural man life. You are called to become a soldier to begin a war again. So there is a war that bettered your calling. And you are called to war. So let's begin to table the matter one after the other to see the reality of the war that happened before you are called. and then begin to talk about the reality of a call upon your life, which talk about the reality that you must war in this life. You must wage war. Now I repeat verse 5. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book. Two things I want to bring out in this Bible verse. One, a Lion of the tribe of Judah. Then number two, prevail. For somebody to be given that identity as a lion, it means he's a soldier. There is an anointing upon his life. There is a personality he carries that has something to do with war. Get this. Jesus has two major identities. One, as a lamp of the world. And number two, as a Lion of the tribe of Judah. As a lamb, he came to be a sacrifice. But as a lion, he came to fight. So if you are a lion, just have the mentality that you are here for war. Lion is one of the personalities in the animal kingdom that the whole kingdom of animals know him as a warfare man. So lion doesn't take anything without fighting. I don't know if you are getting what I'm saying.
Yes,
before lion will hit, he must war. Is a nature, is an ordination upon lion that before he do or did anything, there must be a war. Before a lion will take a territory, there must be a war. So the whole kingdom of animal know this man. Each time they see lion, they know he's coming to kill. So and that personality was used to explain a divinity. And he identified himself as a lion. That is, each time you see me in that dimension, I didn't come on here to play. It's a war. So when he was born, he first manifested as a sheep. And John was able to look at him. And John said, behold, this is what? The lamp of the world. So as a lamb, his assignment is to come and die and become a sacrifice so that we can have ordination before the God of the Father. That is as a lion. So and as a lamb, I mean to say, so as a lamb, his assignment ended on the cross as a lamb. The assignment of a lion started from the grave. And when he appeared in the grave, we saw him in the book of Psalm chapter 23. He said, lift up your head, O ye what? O ye gate, and lift up your head, ye everlasting door. He said, the King of glory is about to enter. And the protocol of air asked him, who is the King of glory? And Jesus responded, the man was mighty in what? In battle. He didn't say, I am the lamp of the world. He didn't say I am meek and gentle. But when it comes to another dimension of him, he begins to talk to the protocol of air. He said, I am a lion, a man mighty in what? In battle. So you have to understand that the dimension of God as a lamb and as a lion. And every Christian, you must understand that you inherit that dimension of the personality of Jesus. There is a dimension of you that is a lamb. There is a dimension of you that is a what? Is a lion. So there are two personalities that every Christian must portray: a sacrificial life as a warfare and a warfare life. I repeat, two personalities that a believer who has been called must portray is number one as a what? As a sacrificial life. A sacrificial life. And two, a what? A warfare life. You can never walk in the corridor of eternity if you are not a man of sacrifice. You can't die in the corridor of immortality if you are not a man who have the capacity to present your body as a what? As a living sacrifice. You can't move in the corridor of eternity. You can never. That's one. And you can never die in the gate of air to stand upon the authority of air and prevail if you are not a soldier of Christ. So let these two realities begin to ring in your mentality that there is a part of me that is a lamb, and there is a part of me that is a what? A lion. So before the call that is upon your life can be in existence, somebody in heaven come down, and his name was called the Lion of the what? Of the tribe of Judah. Then the second statement in that verse, he said he prevailed. A lamb doesn't prevail. It is a lion that what? That prevail. As a lamb, you surrender and die. But as a lion, you fight and what? And prevail. And prevail means to fight and conquer. And Paul was privileged to enter into the cosmos of immortality. And he saw this reality. And he said he ascended. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 8. He said, I know a man who ascended into the Most High, and he led the captivity captive. And he what? He gave gifts to upon man. So before the gift in you can come into reality, somebody have to put the captivity into what? Into captive. Kai. Apostle Joe, are you getting me, sir?
Yes, sir.
Before the gift that is manifesting in you was able to begin to come into existence in your life, there is a personality that war, that bound the principality. He put the captivity into captive, and now say he gave gift to a man. So what is the relationship between the gift he gave and the war and the captivity? So that is, if he did not put the captivity into captive, he can never release the gift. You don't have the right to access the gift until a personality from air is being what? Bound and put into captive. So what simply means, before the call, the ordination of upon your life come to reality, there was a war.
Oh God, can we speak it up for a few minutes?
Before the call of God upon your life come to reality, there was a war in heaven. The same call you are taking for granted, somebody war before you release it.
Hey God, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Now, as it is settled in your heart now, that what you call the gift manifesting in your life,
before you have the capacity, the authority, the right to receive it, somebody did what?
He war to get it.
So, for you to know that the value of what to carry can never be bought by any money. It was not a gift that was given to you because somebody paid earthly money. There was a war. It involved a life. And now the call landed upon your life. This is what I'm going to know. A war to call. And what? A call to what? To war. So there was a war before you were called. And the moment you are called, permit me to give you this news, that you are called to what? To war. The gift of God upon your life is a weapon of warfare. You are not called for pleasure. You are called for purpose and assignment. And the assignment has something to also put the captivity what? Captive. Before Christ can release gifts unto man, he put the captivity captive. Before you can also release the gifts, and the gift will begin to produce effect in the life of man, you must also put captivity what? Captive. There is a dimension of captivity you must put into captive before you can release those that have been put under the bondage of air. Hear this. Jesus said something. He said, no man can enter into the house of a powerful man without first what? Bound the man. You know, only go send to the world alagbara. So bash the coco be alagbara likini. Oh, they need beku. For you to know that an assignment of Christianity is not a pleasure. It's not for pleasure. Hagada gada. Mo deko sha.
If Jesus, before he can release the gift to you, the Bible said, he put the captivity captive and he gave Apostle James, he gave him a dimension. Sir, before you can release that gift and bless life, you must also put captivity captive. You must also. So that is why it must begin to ring in your life that the moment you are called, you are a soldier. That's the first thing I want to talk about this night. That you are called to war. So you are not just a Christian, you are a soldier of Christ. Because we need to come back now and gather ourselves in this conference room and begin to redefine the meaning of a Christian. He's a soldier of what? Of a Christ. It is only when you don't have gifts that you are not among the soldier. The moment the gift of the Spirit begins to manifest in your life, sir, ma, that is here even now, you are a soldier. Because that gift in the corridor of heaven is a weapon of mass destruction. That gift, according to the protocol of heaven, is a battle axe. Somebody said, I'm not calling to full-time pastor. Mine is to help people and deliver them from poverty. Before you can deliver somebody from poverty by giving him money, who put him in that poverty? A devil put somebody in poverty? And you think by giving him money we solve his problem? He will lose the money again. Eh? I was telling somebody, I said, somebody is under the bondage of poverty, you give him 1 million. He won't know the way he spent the 1 million naira. He will not be able to give record. Because until you deliver him from poverty, before you can bless him with prosperity. Somebody is under the influence of the spirit of sickness, you are giving him a job. Even though you lay hands and the sickness vanishes, as long as the spirit is still there, the sickness will come back again. Because spirit has the capacity to attract anything in the name of the spirit. So if the spirit in you is not holy, it can attract any evil thing. Are you getting me, sir? So before you begin to manifest any of your assignment, there is a personality called captivity that you must put into captive. I am called to release knowledge. And you think the spirit of ignorance, I will just be looking at it. I must war against that spirit before I release the knowledge. I must. So tell me your assignment. I will tell you that there is a spirit from air that is war that you must fight before you can dispense your assignment, and the assignment will bear fruit. What I discovered in the body of Christ is like we have a good seed, but we don't clear the land before planting the seed. We are carrying a good seed. Until you clear the land, there is nothing you will plant in it that will germinate. Jesus himself began to explain. He said there is a word. He said if enter the tombs, only a good fupa, as powerful as the word of God, it enter into a tombs. And the Bible said the tombs will not allow you to bear fruit. What is now your gift? That you can think you can enter eternity without binding the principality and power. And you think you can begin to manifest the power. It won't produce results until you put the captivity into captive. And what? And give gifts unto all man. It's a protocol. So that is why before you can begin to succeed in any of your assignment, you must number one know that you have a call to be a soldier of what? Of Christ. And not a civilian Christian. Now the question is, who are civilian Christians? And who are soldiers of Christ? A civilian Christian are those who are born again but did not know they had a call. I repeat. I don't know, you know we have many of them.
Sure.
The moment you are born again and you did not know you had a call, you are a civilian Christian. Number two, there are those who are born again, but they are living in pleasure. They never know they are born for a purpose. They are born again and begin to born for pleasure. This is number two. I repeat number one. Those who are born again and did not know they have a call. Number two, those who are born again and never know they are born for a purpose, they begin to live for pleasure. So for those who are listening to me online now, I want to ask you, Are you a soldier of Christ or you are a civilian Christian? Because the conference room of immortality is not an association for the civilian Christians. No, it's not. That is why it's not the multitude that are not needed there. There are those who have discovered that I have assignment on earth, and that assignment has to do with establishing the kingdom of God and demolishing the kingdom of darkness. Establishing the kingdom of God and what? Demolishing the kingdom of darkness. The call was given to Jeremiah, and God began to draw him nearer in the conference room of his immortality and began to download the information of his assignment into him. And he said, you have been ordained as a prophet. And remember what he said? To pull down. To do what? To pull down. Jeremiah chapter 1. To destroy, then to build. So you can never build until you pull down. Get this? Anywhere you will see light, darkness has once been there. It is a protocol of the kingdom that darkness will come before light. Sickness will come before healing. Poverty will come before prosperity. It's a protocol. Every evil usually comes before what? Before good. Satan came in the garden before Jesus came in the book of Luke. So, before you manifest any good thing, there must have been a territorial power and principality governing the counsel of the existence in that environment. And if you lack capacity to put down the gate of hell, if you lack the capacity to tear the gate of hell and lift up your head, holy gate, and lift up your head, ye everlasting door, because the children, the king of glory, is about to what? To enter. Because in the realm of the spirit, you may be known as Joshua Gumbelu, but in the corridor of power, you are known as Lord. In the physical realm, you may be known as Evangelist James, but in the realm of the spirit, you are known as God. How God? Jesus said, God said unto Moses, he said, didn't you know that you are what? A God unto Pharaoh. You are not a God unto Goliath. Get this revelation here. For Moses is a God unto what? You can be a God unto poverty. Am I communicating to somebody? We can't be a God to every agent of darkness. There is a dimension of agent of darkness that you are a God to. The one you are assignment capture is the one you are God to. Moses was not called to Jericho. He's not a God to what? To Jericho. Moses was not called to Goliath. He's not a Lord, a God to Goliath. But his assignment is unto Pharaoh. And God said, I have made you a God. Unto who? Pharaoh. And I ask you, you are God to who? I ask you, you are God to who? And that is what he has heard in the spirit. To echo into your spirit now. You are God to who? If I'm a God or the spirit of ignorance walking in the territory of my environment, I ask you, you are God to who? There are many people here who are God to sickness, but in themselves, they are in sickness. Eternity is saying, I have made you a God to poverty, but there's no money in their own account. You are God to who? Now the first question. Who are the soldiers of Christ? I just want us to prepare our mind. Because that God in us must come out tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. He must. People in the environment must be able to see that we are man who have been with God. Because no man can do what we are doing except the Lord is what? He's with him. We must be able to transform our corruption, our incorruptible body must be able to put on the corruptible body. Our immortality must be able to put on the mortality and become vivid to people in the environment that we are a man who have encountered God. That no man cannot play in this dimension except the God of eternity, who is the Lord of heaven and earth, has come to your body to become a father and landlord in the system of your body. Then I ask, who are the soldiers of Christ? Number one, they are those who know they are called, and two, who have discovered their calling. I repeat.
There are those who know their call and who also know that they who know their call and who also who have discovered the area of their calling.
There are many people who know they are evangelists, but they cannot define the area of their calling.
So before eternity begins to see you as a soldier, you must know your call and know the area of your calling.
Get this. When you see a man holding cutlass, you don't need anybody to tell you he's a farmer. Are you getting me now?
Yes. Because by the tools you are holding, I can predict your profession. Mm-hmm. So the same thing in the calling of the Holy Ghost. The moment eternity begins to download and they discover your gift, they can tell you your assignment. So by your gift, you should know your assignment. So for those who are watching me, I ask you, what is your gift? You don't need much revelation to know your assignment. By your gift, you know your assignment. So, and number two, there are those who have known, it has become reality to them that they don't need to entangle themselves with their fears of this earth. You know, I say no soldiers. We entangle himself with their fears of the world. That what? That will please the master who sent him. You can't. You can't. A civilian Christian can entangle himself with their fears of the earth. But the moment they begin to ring in the echo of your spirit that you are a soldier, get this into your mentality and jot it in your book now. That if you try to entangle yourself with their fear of the earth, you won't please the man, the father that sent you. If God is calling you into circular, you are there for a purpose, not for pleasure. If God is calling you into ministry, you are here for purpose. Eternity did not see you as a blessed man until you bless life. So life is not governed by the amount of what you have, it's governed by the amount of what you release. So those that get blessed through you are those eternity recalled as part of people who are producing results on it. So if God gives you a job, one, there is an assignment God wants you to do there, one, or two, the money you have there, you receive there as a salary, God wants you to use an assignment. Am I speaking to somebody now?
Yes,
so is it that one, if God gives you a contract today, sir, it's not to buy a car first. If God is giving you money to buy a car, the car is not for pleasure, it's for what?
It's for purpose.
If God gave house today, the house is not for pleasure, it's for what?
It's for purpose.
So when God gives you a job, the salary you get from that job may be what God wants to use. And it is unfortunate that all you could pay in that money is tithe. And the next thing is that you go to Mr. Beast and begin to eat uneatable thing. You begin to die in the corridor of pleasure.
Hey, God.
And eternity begin to whisper and say, look at my investments. That no return. To some, you give them 5 talents. That your salary can be your talent. Eternity expects you to use it to produce results. The moment you have the money, the kingdom wants you to ask, what is this salary for? Where am I needed in your kingdom to expand? I said it in one of my teachings. I said money is a tool for the expansion of the kingdom. The power and the wisdom is a tool for the establishment of the kingdom. While money is a tool for what?
For expansion.
So just as we need the gift of the spirit for establishment, we need money for what?
For expansion.
And there are people God has been blessed with that money. Just as he blessed us with gifts of the spirit, he blessed them with money. Money is a gift in the realm of the spirit. But it's unfortunate. They went to buy a jeep of 12 million. They are riding the school fees. They are riding the destiny. They are riding the empowerment of widows, and they call it Ferrari jeep. Just calculate 100,000, divide it by 12 million. The school fees of those whom God wants him to use the money to pay, maybe just 50 school fees today. But it's unfortunate. But they use this destiny of 120 students. They use it to buy jeep, and they are riding it about. And eternity
whisper. I provide this money for you so that people can be get, can be blessed through you. But you get the money and use it for yourself. You are not a soldier of Christ. So there are those who know their call, and two, they know the area of their words, of their calling. That's number one. Then number two, I said, there are those who know that they are living on earth not for pleasure, but to please the master who sent them. So we simply mean they must not entangle themselves with their fears of what? Of the world. Of the world. I said it. Truly, the Bible said we should go into the world. But we are not to go into the world and be like the world. Our assignment is to get out of the world, then be loaded in the world, then go back to the world and manifest the word of God in the way, in the world. I repeat, our assignment is to get out of the world, be rooted and loaded in the word of God, then go back to the world and manifest the word where, in the world. Then the third set of soldiers, there are those who know that life is a sacrifice. A soldier doesn't live anywhere aside from barrack. This place is a barrack. Am I communicating?
Yes.
Here now, where we are, is a what? Is a barrack. In the physical realm, you call it palo. In the realm of the spirit, is a what? Is a barrack. Before for five soldiers and six soldiers to be here, they can't be anywhere aside from where? Aside from barrack. So each time we have a car, we don't have a car for pleasure. We have a car for pleasure, for the assignment of the kingdom. So we live a sacrificial life. We don't have a life of ourselves. Jesus said, "Whosoever man that want to follow me, let him what? Deny himself, then pick up his cross and what? And follow me." He said, "There is no man that want to follow me that will not first lost his father, lost his children, lost his everything, and pick up his cross and follow me." He said, "Truly, you will still have that thing, but seek first the kingdom of God first, and every other thing will be what? Mm-hmm. A sacrificial life. A sacrificial life." Then the last one, a soldier listening to one message majorly, which is the message of the cross. The message of the cross is a message that the eternity has ordained to use to prepare soldiers for the assignment of the kingdom. The moment you have been shortlisted for soldiers, what you are trained to be is not to be delivered. You are trained to be a deliverer. Am I speaking to somebody? So it's not an association where we gather and begin to fight our own battle. We gather to be trained to fight people's life battle. Am I speaking to somebody? And begin to say, "Sir, what is your problem? Yeah, give us your prayer point." And number one prayer point is that, "I want to marry this year." Then number two prayer point is that, "I want to have a good job this year." We don't gather in the conference room of soldier to discuss those things. We gather on how to take territory. We gather on how to discuss on how to conquer or shield for Christ. We discuss on how to expand the kingdom of God to over island. That's what we discuss. Because it's a prayer we gather to prepare ourselves for the journey ahead. A message of the cross. It's a dimension of the gospel that the body of Christ don't want to hear. 7 keys of prosperity, you see them jotting. 4 things you need to know to get married, you see them jotting. They fail to know that if you seek first the kingdom, all those things will what? Because you can't marry anybody less than soldier yourself. So the person you will marry will enter into the barrack. The assignment will bring him to the barrack. Am I communicating to somebody? You can't marry anybody less than soldier. A soldier is the one that marries soldiers. If a soldier tries to marry civilian, he will connect the gun and give it to the world. So we are not concerned. We need deadly things, but we are not concerned about deadly things. Because we know that there is no soldier that go into the war field at the expenses of his what? Of himself. So there must have been a government he's working for, and that government will be responsible for his salary, man. The government will be responsible for the gun. The government will be responsible for his uniform. So the moment you are soldier of Christ, eternity is ready to be responsible for your finances. Eternity is ready to be responsible for your what you need to war. I don't bother to pray for guilt. The moment I'm in alignment as a soldier, God, we automatically come. Am I communicating to somebody? I don't pray for guilt or the spirit. I don't. Mine is to be in alignment. Discover my call. Discover my purpose. Prepare for the purpose. Automatically, the federal government or the government room of immortality, they will provide weapons needed for me to be relevant in the corridor of air and deliver souls and deliver lives whom the devil has put in the bondage of the hellfire. For those who are hearing me, I ask you, are you living for purpose or you are living for pleasure? Are you living a sacrificial life or you are living a satisfactory life? What are the kind of message that you are exposing your spirit, souls, and body to? Is it the message that pleases your soul, or the message that draws you out of iniquity and draws you into the corridor of righteousness, or the message that prepares you for the assignment of the kingdom? What's the message you are exposed to? Is it 70 to prosper? Or 70 to become soldiers of Christ? Shall we bow down our heads and begin to bless him?
Begin to cry to God. Shout this